chimneys mean the arms, they mean the hands and the feet and the legs and the arms.
And in cases involving stab wounds or the use of a knife to inflict injuries, is defensive wounds something, or are defensive wounds, the kind of thing that, as a forensic pathologist, you are looking for?
Yes.
And on a form like 23, is this where you would expect them to be diagrammed, at least with respect to the hands?
Yes.
Mr. Fertlow, the next one. And what is this type of diagram, a 22, to be used for?
This diagram is used to document injuries in the head and neck area.
Okay, and would that include stab wounds?
It would include any type of injury one may see on a person.
The next one, Mr. Fertlow. Again, doctor, is this Form 21 to be used in the course of the autopsy?
Yes, this is a side view of the body. We use this diagram because this gives you a better view of the flank area, which I demonstrated earlier.
And the next one, Mr. Fertlow. Form 28, what does this show, doctor?
This shows the skull cavity after the skull cap has been removed as we see it in the autopsy room.
And the next one? A Form 27?
This is a diagram which shows the skeletal system with an outline of the body around it to document any fractures or injuries, penetrating injuries through the rib cage or bony cage. It is a good form to diagrammatically represent what you want to demonstrate.
Doctor, going back briefly to Form 28, you've already identified from Form 29 the brain form, this issue of no injuries. What you identified on June 22nd as this contusion to the cerebral cortex of Nicole Brown Simpson's brain tissue, would you expect that to be diagrammed on this form?
No, not the brain contusion. The brain contusion is diagrammed only in the brain diagram.
And on this form, if there is any kind of sharp force injury to the skull, like a knife striking the skull, would you expect that this would be the form where it would be diagrammed?
Yes.
I think we're done with those forms. And may I just collect those from Dr. Lakshmanan? Doctor, I want to get into a discussion now of sharp force injuries, so we'll have a little more detailed understanding of that. Let's start off with first just your definition of sharp force injuries.
A sharp force injury is one which is caused by a sharp instrument. There could be stab wounds or incised wounds, and the sharp instrument could vary anywhere from a knife to a broken glass or an open scissor, which could be each blade of the scissor acting like a knife. I just gave you a few examples.
Your Honor, I have a board which I asked to be marked as Exhibit 331. And I'm not certain where is the best place. Mr. Fertlow is our expert on this.
I don't know, would that location right there be appropriate?
If it's good for the jury, the court, and defense counsel.
Well, I think we need to turn it so it's parallel. Fine. And the doctor needs to be able to see it too. I think we need it back some.
He may have to step to the board. And also, Mr. Fertlow has the capability, and I'd ask that he put this particular Exhibit 331, which is our page 140, Mr. Fertlow. Doctor, just in general terms, what are we looking at on this diagram?
What this?
You're going to have to keep your voice up, too, Doctor. So maybe can we swing this microphone?
I think he's just going to have to shout from there. Yes. That's not going to work.
What we're trying to show here is the correlation between the knife and wound dimensions. The example here is a single-edged knife. The reason is the description of the injuries on the body correlate with certain class characteristics of a weapon. The length of the blade usually corresponds to the depth of the stab wound in the body. The width of the blade corresponds to the length of the wound on the body surface. The thickness of the blade corresponds to the width of the wound on the body surface. So I'll show you another diagram which explains this further.
All right, Doctor, this title for this particular exhibit includes single-edged knife, which you defined earlier. Is this, in fact, a depiction of a single-edged knife?
Yes, because you can see that this edge is blunt. You can see the blunt edge here of the knife. That is, this edge will not be sharp in contrast to the other edge, which would be the sharp cutting edge of this knife.
Doctor, in your training as a forensic pathologist, are you taught about class characteristics of knives?
Yes.
Are you taught about how you look at class characteristics of knives for the purpose of seeking to identify from the wounds to the body the kind of knife that may be responsible for the wounds?
Yes. We look at the wounds. We look for simple penetrating wounds, which will help us to give some estimate as to a class characteristic for knife. And class characteristic means the length of the blade, the width, and the thickness of the blade.
Doctor, do single-edged knives come in all different dimensions of thickness, width, and length?
Yes, they do.
Your Honor, I have a series of knives.
Yes, that's true.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear Mr. Shapiro's.
Yes, with the court reporter, please. All right, Mr. Kelberg, you may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. I was about to mark some exhibits.
I have a knife that has the inscription Grand Chef Saboteur, not in the sinister sense, S-A-B-A-T-I-E-R. I'd ask that this and its sheath be marked as Exhibit 332.
All right, 332.
I have what appears to be a knife with a black handle and the word Forchner, F-O-R-S-C-H-N-E-R, and a number 810-7 be marked as 333.
333.
I have what appears to be another knife, this with a brown wooden handle, Forchner, and the number 405-6 as 334.
So marked.
And finally, a knife that has a black handle and the words Black Panther Solingen, S-O-L-I-N-G-E-N, Germany. May this and its sheath, minus the price tag, I hope, Your Honor?
Yes.
Be marked as Exhibit 335.
So marked.
Doctor, first of all, you've had a chance to look at these knives before, is that correct?
Yes.
And the purpose of these knives is to give the jury an understanding of the differences in class characteristics of knives, is that correct?
Yes.
There is no representation made that any one of these knives is in any way connected to any of the injuries sustained by either Nicole Brown Simpson or Ronald Goldman, is that correct?
Yes.
All right, and ladies and gentlemen, I'm allowing the use of these knives solely for demonstrative purposes to display to you different types of knives, all right, just for illustrative purposes.
Thank you, Your Honor. Now, Doctor, and perhaps you can step to the board again. In this area of thickness of blade, and looking at the knives, let me start with the first knife that was marked in this series. Can you demonstrate for the jury, and perhaps it would be better if you actually went to about the middle of the jury box. I'm not sure what. Okay, but I'm not sure that, Mr. Fairlow, can you put this on? Okay.
That's good.
That'll be easier.
All right.
All right, you're referring to 332?
Yes, Your Honor.
Is that the one from the sheath?
Yes.
What you're seeing is the width of the blade here. The lower end is the sharp end, and if you turn the blade, you can see the lower end is the sharp end. And you turn the blade to the other side, you'll see the dull end of the blade. You can see it's dull. And this is an example of a single edge blade which was seen on the diagram.
Now, if Mr. Fairlow can hold that one and also hold what is Exhibit 333, excuse me, so that we can see the width of the blades, thickness, I'm sorry, of the blade, of these two blades, to see if there's any difference.
They have to be held parallel to each other. Not parallel, they'll be parallel in a showing the thickness so that you can see the thick, yeah.
Now, Doctor, is this again a single-edged knife?
Yes, both of them appear to be single-edged knives.
In your experience, are there single-edged knives which have thicker blades?
Yes, they do.
Are there single-edged knives which have longer blades?
Yes, they do.
And in showing if Mr. Fairlow can lay them on their sides, is there a difference in the width of these two knife blades?
The one on the top looks thicker than the one on the bottom, but I need to measure them to be exact. But the one on the upper one, this stockier knife appears to be having a thicker blade than the lower blade.
Doctor, assuming one took these two knives and inflicted a stab wound on a human being, How, if at all, would the difference in the width of the knife blade appear with respect to the stab wound that you would see on the surface?
Yeah. The general dictum in knife wounds is a smaller knife can cause a larger wound because of the rocking motion, which I'll discuss a little bit later. But usually a larger knife cannot cause a smaller opening in the skin. For example, if you take the knife, which the arrow is pointing to right now, has a wider blade near the base, near the handle. Contrast that to the lower knife, where the knife blade is not as wide. It looks as though it's just half as wide. I've not measured the knives. And so if you have a wound which has the depth of this knife, there is no evidence of any rocking motion, and it's a straight penetration, you can see that the other knife at that depth will be having a longer wound on the body surface because it's wider.
Your Honor, I have another board.
Mr. Kelberg, I just think we ought to have the record reflect that the upper knife in this record is 332, the lower knife being 333.
All right, that's fine. Thank you, Your Honor.
All right.
And I have another board which I would ask to be marked
336.
Thank you, Your Honor. And I need Mr. Lynch's assistance here. And Mr. Farrell, I think if you can put this and focus in on the.
We need to move it back.
Can you see that?
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you.
Can I approach the board, Your Honor?
Yes.
In just a second, if you'll wait, Doctor, I think Mr. Farrell is going to be able to bring that up
on the elmo in case some of the jurors cannot see from the distance.
Mr. Farrell, it's on page 142. Thank you. Now, Doctor, what you were just talking about in looking at this diagram on 336, and in particular this upper left-hand area of the diagram, does this relate to that discussion?
Yes. If you look at this diagram, this is an example of a simple stab wound where there is no movement of the knife, there has been no movement of the subject, and the knife has done a straight penetration. And in this particular instance, the knife has almost entered the person to its fullest extent, almost to the handle part of the knife. What I was trying to refer in the earlier discussion was that this width of the blade will correspond to the length of the wound on the body surface, this wound. So if you have a knife which at, let's say, at 5 inches is only half an inch wide at the base, it with a straight penetration, I'm not talking about complex wounds, straight penetration, it should leave a half an inch wound on the skin surface. And of course, I'm not going into the elasticity of the skin at this point. I'm just assuming that there's no elasticity. It would reflect the width of the blade. But if you have a knife which is wide, like we saw on the upper one.
332, I think.
332,
it was.
At the same length, the knife is quite wide. So naturally, that knife will not be able to cause this type of wound, because if it had to cause a longer wound on the body surface, by looking at the wound, you can tell that knife did not cause this type of wound because of the size of the length of the wound.
Doctor, in shorthand, if the knife penetrates to its thickest portion, I'm sorry, widest portion, and you had those two knives before, would the wider knife be expected to leave a longer wound on the surface of the body?
Yes.
And now, in the part of the exhibit that we have up there, that simple stab wound, in the silhouetted form of the knife, the tip does not appear to be in as far as the tip is of the fully formed out knife. Do you see that?
Yes.
And so, assuming that that silhouetted form represents the same knife, but the depth of penetration is different, would the length of the wound be different even though the same knife is involved in creating both wounds.
Could you repeat your question?
Yes. Using the silhouetted form that's there above, you see the outline?
Yes.
Let me approach. Let me borrow the pointer if I could, please. I'll call this the silhouetted form.
Okay.
And you see, Doctor, do you not, that the penetration depth is shorter in that silhouetted form than in the form that shows the knife as it actually appears?
I follow that.
All right. Now, Doctor, assuming that that silhouetted form is the same knife, only the depth of penetration is less, does that affect the length of the wound on the surface of the body that that knife will leave?
Yes, because the most knives taper towards the tip. So if the knife has not fully penetrated the body, the reflection on the skin surface will only reflect the portion of the blade which entered the body.
Doctor, can the same knife, therefore, leave different stab wounds of different lengths, even though it's the same knife involved, depending on the depth of penetration?
Absolutely.
Doctor, is it recognized in forensic pathology that that is the case, that a single knife can leave stab wounds on a body which have all different appearances?
Yes.
And is that something that is indicated usually by a photograph in recognized forensic pathology texts?
Yes.
Objection to what I next wish to use. I don't know if the court wishes to take its recess at this point.
Yeah, we'll do that. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our normal recess at this time. Please remember all my admonitions to you. Don't discuss the case amongst yourselves. Don't form any opinions about the case. Don't conduct any deliberations till the matter has been submitted to you. Do not allow anybody to communicate with you with regard to the case. And we'll stand in recess until 3 o'clock. All right, Doctor, you can step down.
The difference in thickness in single-edged knives, I want to show you 334 and 333. 333 is the black-handled knife. 334 is the, I'm sorry, 334 is the brown-handled knife. A doctor, again, both of these are single-edged knives, is that correct?
Yes.
If you could take for a moment, just as we start this process of comparison, I want to start by putting Exhibit 333 up on this board that has been marked as 336. Can you hold it up there to superimpose it over? Now, Doctor, if I mark with this marker right here with a straight line, not so straight, but well, passes close to straight, at the point of penetration of the skin at the area where the knife blade has been inserted, would that represent, if you will, the length of the wound on the body?
Yes, if it's a straight penetration.
If you take the same knife, if you would, Doctor, and try and superimpose it on the earlier silhouetted form, in the point of penetration, I'm drawing another line which is closer to the tip of the knife blade. Is that an accurate reflection of the length of the wound on the body where the depth of penetration is as depicted in the diagram?
Yes.
Now, if you can give me that for just a second, and Mr. Farrow tells me that he can put this on the Elmo, and we can actually take a picture of it because this is not a permanent marker, Your Honor.
Apparently not.
appears that Mr. Ferretlow's got as nervous a hand as I do.
No, that's pretty normal.
Oh. For him or for me, Your Honor?
That's normal.
Now, Mr. Ferretlow, you're printing a picture, so we can...
All right. I'd like you also, if you could please, to put these two knives. We used a different set of knives for comparison, originally on thickness of blade.
If you can do the same thing you did, because I think it's a clear distinction. No, Doctor, I'm sorry. Or Mr. Ferretlow. Yes, that's what I want to do. If you can turn these, I'm not sure if it's... Doctor, as we are looking at these now, is the difference in thickness of blade between these two exhibits, 333 and 334, visible?
Yes. The lower knife seems to be having a thicker blade than the upper knife there on the screen.
And I'm not sure if Mr. Ferretlow can get our pointer out. And that knife is the black-handled knife, which is going to be exhibit 333. And then the one below, that has the thicker blade. Is that correct, Doctor?
Yes, yes.
Now, Doctor, looking at the depiction again in 336, and thank you, Mr. Ferretlow. And by the way, Your Honor, could the picture that was generated of the measurements of the different areas on the same knife, 333, be marked as exhibit 337?
How about 333A?
That's even better. I think, Mr. Ferretlow, you don't have to hold them there any longer. Now, Doctor, in pointing to the horizontal area going across where that wound is on the body, do you see that?
I mean,
yes, not the length anymore, but the horizontal distance from one side to the other, no, of the wound itself. On the body, on the surface of the body.
And this ends, the ends of the wound?
Yes, and if Mr. Ferretlow can get that back up. There we go. The horizontal, perhaps Mr. Ferretlow with the arrow can show. The distance from side to side of that particular wound. You see that, Doctor? Not the height, that's the length, right? Up and down is the length.
Yes.
And side to side is the width, correct?
That's kind of what he pointed out earlier.
Okay. The width
of the blade is this part. The length is this part.
Okay. I'm not making myself clear, Doctor. I now am focusing on the wound on the body surface, not the blade.
Okay.
The wound.
The wound on the body surface here.
Up and down, is that the length of the wound?
That's correct.
Side to side. Side to side. Is that the width of the wound on the surface? Mr. Ferretlow is working on the knife blade. Forget the arrow and forget the knife blade.
That is the width of the wound on the body surface, and that will be the width which may or may not correspond to the thickness of the blade.
Okay, that's what I want to talk about. That thickness that we were looking at between exhibits 333 and 334, does that have some significance when you look at the width of the wound as it appears on the surface of the body?
Yeah. It's not. This width has some significance, but the width we are concerned with when we evaluate a wound and correlate it with a knife is the ends of the wound. We look at the ends of the wound to see whether the ends of the wound are sharp, like in this picture here, or they are blunted or squared off. And that would be a reflection of the blunt end of the knife.
In the abstract sense, Doctor, does the thickness of the blade, as the inset of Exhibit 336 indicates, does the thickness of the blade correspond in some fashion to the width of the wound on the body?
Yes. If you look at this picture here, you can see that the thickness of the blade corresponds to some extent to the width of the wound here.
Now, is there a limitation that you as a forensic pathologist have to deal with in using the width of the wound on the body to estimate the thickness of the blade at that point of penetration?
Yes. One is the elasticity of the skin, which is an important factor. And also, if it's a thin single-edged blade, the blunt edge of the blade may not reflect its blunt edge on the wound on the body, it looked like as though it's a double-edged knife.
I'll get to that in a little while, but with the court's permission, could the witness step down in front of the jury, and perhaps I can hold the knife so that the jury can see? Perhaps if I could just first walk down and let them have a chance to see it, and then I'll ask Dr. Lakshmanan some questions. And Mr. Lynch, could you hand me the other knife that was Exhibit 334?
Mr. Kelberg, haven't we already demonstrated the relative thicknesses of the blade on the Elmo?
I'm not sure how clear it is, Your Honor. We're now going to talk about the identification of wound patterns based upon the thickness.
It was already demonstrated on the Elmo, the relative thickness.
If the court's satisfied that it's clear, then that's fine. I don't need to do this anymore. Doctor, let's take a look at Exhibit 333. Does the thickness of that blade change as one moves, if you could hold it up too, does the thickness of that blade change as one moves from the handle of the blade to the tip of the blade?
Yes, both the thickness and the width of the blade narrows as it goes towards the tip. So the tip of the blade is not as thick or as wide as it is in the proximal portion of the blade near the handle. So this tip of the blade is much thinner and less wider.
As a result of that, in this kind of knife, assuming this kind of knife is used to inflict two stab wounds like we talked about before, and in one stab wound it's like we have it in this diagram where the knife goes all the way to the handle, and in the other stab wound it goes in only to the level depicted in the silhouette, would you expect the width of the wound to differ between those two wounds, even though the same knife is involved in both stab wounds?
Hold.
You may answer the question.
You would see a difference because in this particular knife, near the tip of the knife is as not as thick as it is in the base of the knife. So the wound which is caused by the knife having penetrated the body fully, you would find that one end of the knife will be slightly blunted. Whereas if the knife had only penetrated up to the this mark portion of it, the knife will look as though it is not blunt on one edge. It looks as though sharp on both ends.
Is the width of the wound, if the penetration is not as deep, is the width of the wound going to appear narrower?
Yes.
Than the width of the wound if there is penetration all the way?
Yes. In this knife, yes.
And assuming that that same knife is used with multiple stab wounds, that same kind of knife with the tapering effect, can you end up on a single individual with many stab wounds, all of which have different widths?
Yes.
All of which have different lengths of the wounds on the body?
Yes.
All of which have different depths of penetration?
Yes. Especially if the knife also has had some rocking motion to it.
And we're going to get to that on this form 336 in just a moment. Doctor, if we can move to the lower part of the same chart, 336, what is intended to be conveyed by this particular box?
This is to show a factor which must be kept in mind when you evaluate knife wounds. If the knife has penetrated a part of the body which is compressible, like the abdomen, where you can press and the knife can go all the way in, and you can also press the skin surface, there's no bony structure there, then the compressibility factor will make the knife penetrate much deeper into the body cavity. So what you will have in that situation is, after the knife has been withdrawn, this is an example, the abdomen has been, let's assume this is the abdomen, and this is a structure in the abdomen. The knife has compressed the abdominal wall, and the whole knife blade has gone to quite a significant depth in the cavity. But when the knife is withdrawn, the abdominal compressibility factor is taken away. The length of the wound track in the body remains the same, but it does not really reflect the length of the blade, because the body compression has created an additional length in the wound track in the body.
In that situation, doctor, does the depth of the wound appear longer than the actual length of the blade that has penetrated the body?
Yes.
Does that create difficulties for you as a forensic pathologist with respect to identifying the specific length of a single knife which may have caused a multitude of stab wounds on a single person?
Yes. That is why when a forensic pathologist reviews the wounds of the body, you would like to pick a wound like is shown on this upper part of this board, where there is a simple penetration and you are confident that the wound track would reflect the true length of the blade as much as possible, rather than pick a wound where you have this compressibility factor which is added to the length of the weapon.
Doctor, I don't think you provided more definition with respect to this concept of the elasticity of the skin and how that affects your ability to get some idea of the measurements of a knife blade. Can you elaborate on that, please?
The skin is in a state of tension in the body because of arrangement of elastic fibers in the area called the dermis. Dermis is just below the skin surface and underlying connective tissue. And the orientation of these elastic fibers are in a particular axis in different parts of the body. The perfect example would be the neck area of the body. These lines of skin tension are called the lines of Langer, but the other term is used also is called lines of Kraissl, K-R-A-I-S-S-L, because Langer worked on cadavers, but Kraissl worked on living people where he could analyze the elasticity better. A perfect example would be the area in the neck. The lines of skin tension run along the crease of your neck and everybody. And that is why, and this is important, because if you have a wound which is at right angles to the skin tension line, the wound would gape. But if the incision is made along parallel to the crease, the wound won't gape. The perfect example is when you go for thyroid surgery, the surgeon always makes an incision like this. He doesn't make an incision like this. Because
just if you'll stop for a second for the record, Your Honor, that Dr. Lakshmanan is going side to side as the way the incision is made on the neck, rather than up and down from the chin down towards the toe area.
Yes.
I'm sorry, Doctor, continue.
So that would be an example to formulate. And these have been well plotted on the body, so surgeons know how to make an incision. You've seen when you go for appendix, always the scars like this. Unless it's an emergency surgery, then they open the abdomen in the midline. But so the surgeons know where the lines of skin tension are. And so what happens is if somebody has a stab wound which is at right angles to these lines of skin tension, the wound will gape. So you have to approximate the wound before you measure. And the same lines of skin tension and the elasticity also will make a wound look smaller than the width of the blade. For example, if the width of the blade is half an inch, if the wound is at right angles or oblique to these skin lines of tension, the wound may look even smaller than what it is supposed to be with the width of the weapon at the point of penetration.
Your Honor, I'm going to ask Mr. Fertlow to put page 296 from Spitz and Fisher Medical Legal Investigation of Death, 3rd edition, on the Elmo. and ask that the photograph that, or the printout that will be presented be marked as our next exhibit, 337. Doctor, what are we looking at in this particular photograph from the textbook?
This is a diagrammatic representation of the human body with the distribution of the Langer's lines. If you focus to one area of the body, like the head and neck, which I gave as an example, we can see, can you go?
Can we zero in, Mr. Ferretlow, on that area? Perhaps on the left?
Let's go to the neck area. This is the front of the body. Can you move the arrow down to the neck area? Can you move the arrow down to the middle of the neck?
Middle of the neck, please.
Yes. And run the arrow from one end of the right end of the neck to the left end of the neck. Just follow the lines there, and that would be a reflection of the lines of Langer in the neck area. If a wound is made parallel to this line of Langer, the wound will not gape. But if the wound is made at right angles to the line of Langer, the wound will gape. And
for right angles, Mr. Ferretlow, could you make
perpendicular to the lines of Langer?
Could you make a line that would be perpendicular to the line you just drew in? No, actually, that's the line you now have drawn, the second line. If you can hold that one on the what would be the right side of the neck of the schematic, and remove the other line, if you can. Okay, we're gonna, now if you could draw at a 90 degree angle, Mr. Ferretlow, to the base of that. Mr. Ferretlow may not have done well in trigonometry.
I think it's geometry.
It may be both, Your Honor. I may not have done so well myself. May I have just a moment to confer with Mr. Ferretlow?
You may.
We'll see if our combined knowledge of the subject is sufficient. We're going to try again. Third time's the charm. Fourth time's the charm.
Yeah, go on. To my left. Just go on. Straight
up. Yes. Well, that's not exactly 90 degrees, but we'll settle for it. Doctor, does this depict in general terms the differences? If you take the line that is running along parallel to or superimposed on top of one of these lines of Langer, what kind of width of the wound on the body would you expect to see?
The wound will not gape and would give you a better reflection of the width of the weapon, and also the length of the wound would be better reflected for the class characteristic of the weapon. But if the wound is at right angles, the short line which is going up from head to toe, which was just removed from the screen, then the wound would gape.
And do these phenomena create difficulties to you as a forensic pathologist in being able to give precision to the dimensions of any knife, assuming for the sake of argument that a single knife is responsible for a multitude of stab wounds on a human body?
This is a factor one has to keep in mind. And that is why when you make the measurements, the wound has to be approximated and measured accurately.
Now, I don't know if Mr. Ferretlow can print that out. That's okay. let's go to the same page and the bottom portion and ask, Your Honor, that this be marked as Exhibit 338 when it's printed out.
338.
And if we could back up, Mr. Farrello, so we can see both sides of the bottom portion. And perhaps raise it. Thank you. Doctor, what is depicted in what appear to be these two photographs from the same page of the book?
The photograph on the right is a gaping stab wound, and the photograph on the left is the same wound after it has been approximated. You can see that on approximation, the wound has a longer length when compared to the wound which is gaping, and if you had measured it in the gaping state.
Is it the standard practice for forensic pathologists such as yourself or Dr. Golden, when seeing gaping stab wounds, to do an approximation of the wound as it was when inflicted?
Yes, and measure it in the approximated state.
Now, Doctor, in the photograph that's on the left side of what's on the board right now, has something been done to hold the approximated state of the wound?
There's been an adhesive tape applied.
In your practice at the coroner's office, is it the custom and practice of your forensic pathologist to use such tape to hold the position of the approximated wound?
No. We approximate the wounds and take a measurement. I think the adhesive tape has been used here so that you could take a good photograph.
Now, if Mr. Farrellow could print this out as, I think I said, Your Honor, Exhibit 338.
338.
And go one page beyond. And again, focus on exactly where you've got it, maybe just a little lower. And if we could move it just a little to the left to see the full right side. And ask, Your Honor, that this printout be marked as Exhibit 339.
339.
Doctor, what are we seeing on the right side and the left side, let's start with, of these two photographs?
The one on the left shows the, which is gaping. And the wound on the right shows an approximated wound, but there's also an extension of an incision.
Now, the approximated wound, there appear to be some fingernails at the top and a finger at the bottom of the photograph of the approximated wound. Is that what you would expect to see from the forensic pathologist who is approximating the wound for measurement purposes?
Yes.
And is this the standard procedure that is done by you and the other forensic pathologists at the coroner's office when dealing with gaping stab wounds?
Yes.
Now, there appears to be some measuring device in the bottom of both photographs on the left and right side. Do you see that?
Yes.
And what is reflected by the approximation of that gaping wound?
It would give a better reflection of the length of the wound than when it was in the gaping state.
And in the approximated state, does the wound have a greater length on the body surface than it would otherwise appear to have in the gaping state?
Yes.
And does it have a narrower width on the body surface than the gaping wound appears to have?
Yes.
And if that can just be printed out, I think we're done with that one. Doctor, you mentioned something about incised wound. I think you mentioned the term before. And I want to invite your attention, if Mr. Farrellow can switch hands and photographs or whatever, and bring up from the same exhibit the upper right-hand corner. Doctor, what is depicted in the upper right-hand box of this exhibit 336?
That is the incised wound. By definition, an incised wound is that the length of the wound on the body surface is greater than the depth. As you can see from the the projected image on the screen, the depth of the wound is very shallow, go to the top of the image, you can see the depth reflected there. And the length of the wound on the skin surface is very long compared to the depth. So this wound, which is shown on the projected image, would fit the definition of an incised wound. And this is in contrast to a stab wound, where the depth of the wound on the body, in the body, will be longer than the length of the wound on the body surface.
And for that comparison, Doctor, I don't know if Mr. Farrellow needs to change images, but if we go back to the upper left-hand block of this exhibit 336, is that clearly shown by what we are seeing on that board?
Yes, and actually, the one which I showed for the compressibility shows it much better.
All right, Mr. Farrellow, he's got that already.
Yeah, see, in this particular wound, you can see that the length on the body surface is much shorter compared to the length of the wound, I mean the depth of the wound, and this would fit the definition of a stab wound. So to repeat, incised wound, the length of the wound on the body surface is longer than the depth, and the stab wound, the depth of the wound is longer than the length of the wound on the body surface.
Doctor, if you have an incised wound, are you able to use that kind of wound to assess class characteristics of the knife that inflicted that incised wound?
No.
Why not?
Because you can have a single-edge blade cause an incised wound, and you will not be able to differentiate it from an incised wound from a double-edged knife, because only one edge is being used, and it can very well cause a cut.
Can you use an incised wound to assess the length of the blade of any particular knife that may have inflicted that incised wound?
No.
Why not?
Because you can have a very small, even a pocket knife, which can cause a 7-inch long wound on the body surface, and you cannot use the length of the wound on the body surface to gauge the length of the knife.
Can you use the depth of an incised wound, which, as you say, by definition, is going to be shorter than the length of the wound on the body? Can you use the depth of the wound to identify class characteristics of the knife with respect to length of the blade, for example?
No.
Width of the blade?
No.
Thickness of the blade?
No.
Now, Doctor, I want to show you Exhibit 335. You mentioned differentiating a single-edged blade from a double-edged blade. Let me show you that knife. Are you familiar with, in general terms, the kind of knife that that is?
This is a double-edged knife. It looks like a dagger.
Let me ask Mr. Farrellow if he would please to just put this up on the Elmo. And also, I'll ask him, let me borrow that. Does Mr. Farrellow still have the other knife? Doctor, by any chance, do you have the other knife?
Oh, yes, I'm sorry.
Let me ask if Mr. Farrellow can put these side by side. 333, you've already said, is a single edge blade. Can you indicate, Doctor, what is the difference between a double edge blade and the single edge blade?
In double edge, both the edges are sharp, and that is the main difference between the double edge and the single edge.
All right, and Mr. Farrellow is turning the exhibit 335, the double edge blade, on its side. Is this one of the sharp edges?
Yes.
And if he turns it 180 degrees, is this the other sharp
edge?
Yes,
yes.
In comparison with the exhibit 333, as he's turned it here, is this the blunt end?
Yes.
And 180 degrees, and that is the sharp edge?
Yes.
Or edge, I should say?
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Farrell. Now, Doctor, if we could move to the bottom box of Exhibit 336, and I think Mr. Farrellow will join us in a moment. What does this represent?
This is what is a complex stab incised wound, which is being diagrammatically represented. And what we have is not only the twisting of the weapon during penetration, as you can see from the arrows going in a clockwise direction around the blade. And we also have a component of rocking motion to the knife, which would create a greater length on the skin surface than what the width of the knife should really reflect. So you not only have turning and twisting of the weapon, but you also have the an incise component to it.
Doctor, with the court's permission, could you step down to in front of the jury box and let me hand you Exhibit 333. I've known you a long time. I assume you will not use this in anything but a careful manner. Can you demonstrate without penetration on me what it is that is this turning and rocking motion that you are talking about?
It could be two ways this can happen. Either the victim moves when the knife is being penetrated, or the knife could be turning when the penetration is taking place. And this is the dynamic twisting of the weapon when that happens. The other one is not only there's a knife penetrating, but also there is a cutting component to the penetration when it's being inflicted, or when the knife is being penetrated, the victim pulls themselves away from the weapon. So that can also cause a complexity and creating the cutting component to the penetrating stab wound.
Doctor, if you use my arm as the area which is going to be penetrated without penetrating, as I say, and without blocking the view of any jurors, I think you're going to have to back up just a bit. Can you demonstrate what you're talking about by just bringing the tip to the edge of my arm?
Overall, do you want to come over here and watch?
No.
Fine.
This is called twisting.
You have to keep your voice
twisting
up.
Twisting and also creating a cutting component.
And if the victim moves, in this case my arm, at the time that the knife is being penetrated, what effect, if any, does that have on the appearance of the wound on the body after the knife is withdrawn?
It'll be a complex wound which will have characteristics which are different from a simple penetration, which is the wound you look for to compare class characteristics.
And how will the wound appear with respect to the accuracy of the actual thickness of the blade, the width of the blade, and the length of the blade?
There will be a lot of variability in the wound. You really will not be able to use that wound for this kind of analysis. It will not reflect even reasonable accuracy.
You'll have to, let me take that back from you.
And you'll retake the stand.
Doctor, does that aspect, this complex stab incised wound, create difficulties for you as a forensic pathologist looking at a body with multiple wounds of that type to identify with any precision the actual characteristics of the knife, that is, the length of the blade, the width of the blade, the thickness of the blade?
It'll be difficult when you use such a wound to do that kind of analysis. So that is why, as I mentioned earlier, a forensic pathologist has to study all the wounds in the body and then pick the wounds which would reflect best a simple penetration, which would give a better evaluation of a class characteristic of a suspect weapon.
And even in the circumstance of a simple stab wound, as indicated in the upper left-hand box, can you with precision identify the length of the blade, the width of the blade, the thickness of the blade?
You can analyze those factors, but as I mentioned earlier, you now have to keep in mind the elasticity factor in mind when you give an opinion as to a particular weapon causing a particular wound.
Doctor, in your practice of many years, in your experience with many cases of sharp force injuries, how common is it for you as a forensic pathologist to be able to identify a specific knife to a specific stab wound in a particular case?
We have done it a few times when the knife is left on the body, penetrated, and the knife is still on the body. The other is when the knife tip breaks and you recover the weapon where the other part of the broken knife, you can match the broken tip to the weapon, and we have done it on a, we have had cases like that. And of course, the other serological markers will also help if there's blood staining on the knife belonging to a particular victim and the knife is found, and that may also help. But as far as wound characteristics go and correlating with a particular weapon, these would be two situations where you could be precise that you have a bit of the knife which matches the weapon, or you have the knife in the body.
And absent those situations, dealing exclusively with wound characteristics of depth of penetration, length of wound on the surface, and width of the wound on the surface, in your experience, are you able to identify a specific knife's dimensions that may be responsible for any stab wound?
We can estimate a class characteristic of a group of weapons, but it'll be difficult to estimate a particular weapon to all the wounds.
Doctor, is there anything further about this chart that you need to identify for a better understanding of sharp force injuries and knife class characteristics?
No.
Your Honor, I have another board. I believe, is this 340, Your Honor? Exhibit 340? I've lost track.
340.
May this board then be marked as Exhibit 340, entitled Wound Characteristics and Possible Sources. And Mr. Fertlow.
If you could go to the top portion. Doctor, in general terms, what is this chart intended to depict?
This is a to depict the wound characteristic on the body surface, correlating it with the width and thickness of the blade.
Now, Doctor, is the appearance of the wound on the body surface, the ends and their appearance, of significance to you as a forensic pathologist in identifying a class of knife or classes of knives which could have inflicted that particular injury?
Yes.
In what manner?
If you look at the image projected on the screen, the appearance of the wound which you see, you have a sharp end, you have a sharp end of the lower part and a blunt squared off end on the upper part. This is the appearance of the wound on the body surface of a simple penetration of a single edge knife, where the upper part would reflect the blunt end of the weapon.
Now, Doctor, the simple stab wound was like that first block that we looked at in the previous exhibit 336?
Yes.
In looking at this particular correlation between sharp and blunt ends, is that correct?
Yes.
And using our exhibit 333, can you point out what it is, which part of the knife leaves which aspect of the wound characteristic?
The square.
And hold it up high, please.
Yeah, the squared off end on the wound, the upper part which the arrow is pointing to, is reflected by this blunt end of this knife. The sharp end of the lower part of that wound on the projected image is reflected by the cutting edge of this blade.
Now, Doctor, if the depth of penetration that creates the blunt and sharp ends, if the depth of penetration changes using this same knife, and the knife has a taper, as you indicated before, how does that affect what you're going to see with respect to the blunt end and the sharp end?
You will not have the same squared off end on the upper part. If you go to the lower picture, you may have a picture like wound number two here.
Mr. Fairlow's going to move us down, I think.
So if the knife only had penetrated to a portion, the same knife may create a wound which is sharp on both the upper and lower ends.
And there are some red lines that go from the top and bottom of wound number two back to that top knife. That top knife is to represent a single-edged blade?
That's correct.
And that's the kind like you're holding 333?
Yes.
And at this depth of penetration, this is a narrower penetration, not as deep, is that?
It's a shallower penetration.
All right. And you're basically at closer to the end of the knife blade. Is that accurate?
Yes.
And when you do so, then you are going to see something in the way of the wound pattern that is different than the one we just saw, even though it's made by the same knife?
Yes.
Are you trained to look for those things?
Yes.
And do you have experience in identifying those things?
Yes.
Now, according to this, we also have something or double-edged knife. Explain that for us, if you would, please.
We had this dagger-type knife shown earlier, which is sharp on both ends. When that knife causes a penetrating wound, you would have a wound as is seen in diagram number two, which is the both the upper and lower ends being sharp.
Doctor, let me hand you exhibit 335. And if you'll hold it up high, and you can use the pointer with the board that we have here rather than just looking at the screen. Show us what you mean.
This dagger-type knife has a sharp end on both sides. And this knife, when there's a simple penetration, will leave a wound just like you see on item two here, with sharp ends both at both ends of the wound on the body surface.
And where the red dotted lines go from the top and the bottom to the depiction on the exhibit 340, is that to show the portion of the knife blade that leaves those two sharp ends?
Yes.
Doctor, you may retake the stand. Is this situation of the double-edged blade one that is created by a similar, that is simple stab wound like we saw before in the very first box of the earlier chart 336?
Yes.
How do you, as a forensic pathologist, or can you, as a forensic pathologist, differentiate if you see such a wound characteristic, two sharp ends, how can you differentiate, if at all, between whether it's a single-edged knife blade or a double-edged knife blade?
It'll be very difficult because you can have a very thin, not-so-thick single-edged knife with a tapering end which can simulate the same appearance. So when you have a wound like that, you cannot say with certainty whether it was a double-edged knife or a single-edged knife. And this is in contrast to wound pattern number one, where you have a definite blunt edge, where you can say with definite, reasonable certainty that it was only caused by a single-edged knife and not a double-edged knife.
Now I'd like you to talk about the last entry, item number three, and the pattern that is depicted in this schematic.
Pattern number three has a sharp, this is again the body surface, we're showing a wound appearance on a body surface, has a sharp end in the lower end, but the other end is forked on the upper end. It's forked. Now, this could happen in two fashions. One, and again, if the knife is, if the single-edged knife is very blunt, towards the base of the knife, some knives are very thick, and the thickness is up to 1/8 of an inch. Those kind of knives, when they do a simple straight penetration, the wound will appear forked on the skin surface because of the width of the, due to the thickness of the blade.
Doctor, showing you what I think is our exhibit 334, this appeared to have been the thicker of the two Forstner single-edged blade knives. Is that correct?
Yes.
Can you point out using that exhibit what it is you're talking about with respect to the thicker blunt end?
This knife, as we go to the base, is quite thick near the base. And actually, if the knife is even thicker than this, you can get
a forking, which you just see in item number 3 on the poster. Because what happens is each end of this thick blade will act like a cutting edge and split the skin. But you can also get the same appearance from twisting of the weapon.
Twisting of what kind of weapon, doctor?
From a double-edged knife. So even though this is a single-edged knife with a pointed end and a forked end, you can have a double-edged knife which can cause a similar wound if there's some twisting of the weapon.
Once again, doctor, how can you differentiate, if at all, as to whether it's a single-edged knife or a double-edged knife if you see a wound pattern such as is shown in diagram 3?
You will have difficulty. You have to be, you have to analyze the wound and also see how thick the forking is. If the forking is between 1/16th or 1/8th inch, it could very well be from a thick single edge blade. But you cannot exclude a double edge knife.
Now, doctor, in your experience and training, are these aspects of wound characteristics and class characteristics of knives and trying to correlate one with the other what you would describe as bread and butter forensic pathology?
Yes.
Anything esoteric about them?
No.
Is there anything further about this exhibit 340 that we need to talk about?
No.
I think it should be.
All right, 341. What's the title of the board?
Wound characteristics and possible sources. No, oh, I'm sorry, it was marked as 340.
All right.
I stand corrected. Doctor, I want to change topics for a moment and discuss something called blunt force trauma. You mentioned it, I think, on Friday, and let's discuss it, if we could please, in a little more detail. First of all, your generalized definition of what blunt force trauma is.
Blunt force trauma is injuries caused by blunt force, which could be anywhere from, as I mentioned earlier, a hammer or a 2x2 striking a person, or a vehicle striking a person in an auto versus pedestrian injury where you have multiple injuries, where the force is a blunt type force.
Your Honor, I have another chart that I would ask to be marked then as Exhibit 341, and it is entitled Blunt Force Trauma.
It is 341.
And I think, Mr. Fairholm, do you have this?
I'm sorry.
Go to the podium.
That's okay.
Doctor, we don't have this to put up on the overhead, so if you can step to the board, the Exhibit 341, and tell us what is shown in this exhibit.
Right, 165, can you see that?
Yes, sir.
Right, thank you.
Go ahead, doctor.
Proceed.
We have a general structure of the skin here. The surface of the skin has some layers of cells, which is called the epidermis. And then you have below that the dermis, in which you have the hair follicles and the sweat glands. And this is where your elastic fibers and Langer's lines, I discussed, is in this region. And then you have the subcutaneous tissue, which is the fatty tissue. And then you have fascia and muscle underneath that. This is the general structure of the skin, a cross section of it. Now, you have different types of blunt force which can leave markings on the skin, and you can tell the difference by looking at the appearance of the wound.
Doctor, if you could retake the stand for just a second, I want to talk about some of the topics of blunt force trauma that are on the board. First of all, there's the word under number 1, abrasions. Is that a form of blunt force trauma?
Yes.
What is an abrasion?
An abrasion is the scraping of the skin. It generally reflects scraping of the epidermis, which is the cells on the top of the surface of the skin. this area, and that is an abrasion, and there could be different types of abrasion injury.
And under one, we have A, something called punctate abrasions. Does that term have significance to you as a forensic pathologist?
Yes.
What is it?
That is an abrasion which is very small and punctate on the skin surface.
When you use a definition within a definition, I
punctate
have to ask.
Punctate means minute, small area.
And B is something called pattern abrasions. What are those?
Pattern is when you have a scraping of the skin, which is pattern following the pattern of the object inflicting that injury. Like if somebody is wearing a weaved dress and they have a blunt force striking them over the dress could leave a pattern on the skin. That could be a pattern abrasion. But you could have an object hitting a surface without any clothing on the surface, but the object may have a pattern to it which could leave a pattern on the skin surface. So that would be an abrasion injury with a pattern. But usually such injuries, when you have an object striking the body which leaves a pattern, will usually be an abrasion contusion. That is, you'll also have bruising of the tissue underneath that area of injury.
Before we get further definition of that, number one, do you have training as a forensic pathologist in being able to identify abrasions?
Yes.
What is it you look for?
You look at the skin surface, and especially if it's a grace abrasion, which an example would be a bullet swiping the surface of the body without penetrating the body, or a scratch abrasion, like a fingernail scratching the body surface, then what happens is, in these type of forces, the skin, top layer of skin is peeled off the surface, so you can tell direction by looking at which end of the wound has piling of the epithelium. For example, in this tangential grace or scratch type abrasion, the skin is being peeled off. Of course, this reflects the epidermis. You have a piling of the epithelium on one end, and you can see this under just gross examination. You may use a magnifying glass. You may need to use magnifying glass sometimes, but you'll be able to see this, and this would reflect either the force went in this direction or the body moved in this direction against that rough surface.
Record, Your Honor, the force would be moving left to right across Exhibit 341, where the tangential word appears. And if the body was moving, the direction would be from the right side of the exhibit to the left side, as the doctor indicated. Now, doctor, what would you, as a forensic pathologist, expect to see in the way of coloration from an abrasion that is inflicted while a person is alive?
Yeah. The abrasions could be anywhere from red-brown to darker colors. And as you can see, that the epidermis is not just a flat surface. It's got some undulations. And underneath the undulations, you have what is called the rete ridges, R-E-T-E-R-I-D-G-E-S, of the dermis, where there is where there are vessels. So when you have an abrasion, you can also have some bleeding from the underlying ridges, which I just alluded to. And you could have some bleeding from an abrasion or oozing of blood and fluid from the abrasion. So by looking at the abrasion, you'll be able to tell whether it looks antemortem when the person was alive, and or if it happened postmortem, when the abrasion will not be the reddish-brown appearance, you'll have more a pale-brown appearance. But if you just have an abrasion on just involving the epidermis, sometimes it's difficult when you don't have any bleeding component to it.
Exhibit 341 also has a term under graze and scratch. Are you familiar with that term, brush burn?
Yes.
What is that?
Brush burn is caused by friction of rubbing against a rough surface where a large area of the body is involved, like somebody dragging a person with the skin coming in contact with the ground surface as they're being dragged. That'll be one example. The other example would somebody who is a pedestrian and is hit by a car, and then they are thrown off, and then they are thrown, dragged along the surface, and that would be an example of, these would be examples of brush burns. So basically, it's caused by the friction of rubbing of the surface against a rough surface.
And how, if at all, are you able to distinguish as a forensic pathologist between what is a brush burn abrasion and a graze abrasion?
Well, graze abrasion is more localized to an area, but a brush burn is usually a terminology used for a larger area of an abrasion in the situations I just described.
Doctor, you mentioned the word contusions. I think you've mentioned it several times in the course of your testimony. What is a contusion?
A contusion is the crushing of the soft tissues where the surface of the skin need not necessarily be broken. That will be just a plain contusion where the skin surface is not broken, but the tissues are crushed and the vessels in the soft tissues bleed, and in lay terminology, this would be a bruise.
Doctor, when you say that the skin surface may not be affected, would you be able to see anything as a forensic pathologist looking at the skin surface of someone who has sustained such a contusion?
It'll be intact. You'll have a bruising of the soft tissues without the skin surface being affected, because if the skin surface has an abrasion, like I just mentioned when I described patterned abrasion caused by a force, then you'll have an abrasion component and a contusion component.
Doctor, assuming that a person has a beating heart, an adequate blood pressure, at the time a contusion is sustained, would there be any obvious indication by color on the surface of the person's body that such event has occurred?
Yes, you'll have bleeding in the soft tissues, and then you can tell that this happened when the person had blood pressure. Usually a fresh abrasion will be a reddish blue or a bluish purple color.
I'm sorry, you said fresh abrasion.
Fresh contusion, I'm sorry.
And what would you expect to see if you have one of these situations where you have both an abrasion and a contusion from the same event? Is that correct, Doctor?
Yes.
What do you expect to see then?
You would see an abrasion, and underlying that area of abrasion, you will see the contusion. And sometimes the abrasion may involve the entire area of contusion, or depending on what kind of force was involved, you may have a smaller area of abrasion surrounded by a larger area of contusion.
Doctor, would you describe these aspects of forensic pathology as bread and butter issues?
Yes.
Anything further that you wish to add about contusions?
Nothing further.
And the third entry says something about lacerations. Is that another form of blunt force trauma?
Yes.
What is that all about?
Laceration occurs when a blunt force strikes the skin surface, and underlying the skin surface there is a bony structure which offers resistance. Then the perfect example would be your skin surface on your skull or forehead area. So if you have a blunt force striking that area, the skin is sandwiched and you have the resisting bony structure underlying the skin, so the skin would tear under when such a force is applied. And an example would be like somebody's head being hit with a crowbar, or somebody, or about 2x2, you will have a tear in the skin.
And in the lower portion of our exhibit 341, there appears to be some schematic representation with the word laceration. What is that intended to show?
That intends to show several things. One, when you have a blunt force which causes the tear, as I just described, you'll also have the contusion and abrasion of the edges. You'll also, since it's a tear in the skin, it won't be a clean-cut tear. You'll have some bridging of tissue in the depth of the laceration.
And again, is that a bread-and-butter issue for a forensic pathologist such as yourself?
Yes.
Doctor, in examining the body of someone like Nicole Brown Simpson or Ronald Goldman, do you attempt to correlate blunt force trauma with the environment in which the decedent's body was found?
Yes.
Why do you do that?
Because it tries to explain the injuries you have observed and documented, and you try and see which environmental factor could be responsible for a particular injury.
And you testified earlier that you have twice visited 875 South Bundy, is that correct?
Yes.
Was one of your purposes in making those visits to look at the environmental surroundings from the standpoint of what could be responsible for any blunt force trauma identified on the bodies of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ronald Goldman?
That is correct. I also saw the location of the various structures in relationship to each other.
Doctor, in general terms, can blunt force trauma be caused by somebody's fist to another person's head?
Yes.
So it doesn't require some object. It can be a body part striking another person's body part?
Yes.
Is there anything else, doctor, in general terms that you want to point out regarding blunt force trauma?
I think we have covered the highlights.
Your Honor, I have another small board. May this be marked as Exhibit 342, entitled Terminology Describing When Injuries Were Received Relative to the Time of Death.
All right, when we pull that up, can we move that up just a little? Can we move it up just a little?
Mr. Farrow, or Mr. Lynn, I'm mechanically inept, so I'm sure I'll break this thing if I try.
All right, Mr. Farrow.
You've already, I think, used two of these terms, doctor, but would you take us through these three terms, what they mean to you as a forensic pathologist?
Antemortem means occurring before death. Perimortem means occurring around the time of death. And postmortem means occurring after death.
And going back just to sharp force injuries, are you trained as a forensic pathologist to look at whether a stab wound, for example, was inflicted before the person died, at or around the time the person died, or after the person was dead?
Yes.
What do you look for?
When you have a stab wound, you have injury to the structures of the body, and if the person is alive, they would have blood pressure, so there'll be bleeding in the tissues along the track of the wound. And looking just at the wound and the bleeding pattern, you'll know that the wound was inflicted when the person had blood pressure and was alive. This is in contrast to a person who is dead. You won't have the same amount of hemorrhage into the tissues. You won't have any hemorrhage in the tissues because they don't have any blood pressure.
And this middle term of perimortem, occurring at or around the time of death, how, if at all, can you distinguish between an antemortem and a perimortem stab wound?
The perimortem will have some hemorrhage, but not much hemorrhage. It would mean that the person sustained the wound towards the end of the, just before the person died, or when the person was almost in shock, when the bleeding for a particular wound should have been more significant than what you see in the wound track.
What does shock mean?
Shock is when you completely lose your blood pressure, and to put it in simple terms, an organ or a part of the body doesn't get any blood supply because the heart is not pumping the blood, there's no blood pressure, so there's no perfusion of the tissues in the different parts of the body.
And perfusion means just the blood supply getting to those areas of the body?
Yes.
So can a person be alive, but as a result of shock have very low blood pressure?
Yes.
And if that is the case, what will you find with respect to this hemorrhaging in a stab wound that is inflicted at the time the person's in shock?
It will not have the same amount of bleeding which you would expect in a person who had a full blood pressure. You'll still see some bleeding. That's how you can still classify it as perimortem, because if you don't see bleeding, and it could very well be a postmortem wound also.
Now, how about blunt force trauma? How do you differentiate the three when you have evidence of an abrasion, for example?
In abrasion, as I told you, you have the effect of the skin surface being peeled, and let's say there's no bleeding, still any reaction to the body which occurs during life will have what's called a vital reaction to it, because there's what's called inflammation reaction in the body. It's normal. If you scratch yourself on the skin surface, you will see there's a red line coming onto it. You're not caused any injury to the skin. If you all just practice and just scratch your skin on the surface, you'll see a red line. And that is the vital reaction which the body does. It's an inflammatory reaction. It's due to production of certain hormones which cause that dilatation of the vessels and causes this hyperemia or engorgement of the vessels. It's due to release of some hormones like histamine and serotonin, S-C-R-O-T-O-N-I-N. So that's one factor you will see, which is kind of, you can see as a vital reaction.
What other factors, if any, would you be looking for to distinguish an antemortem from a perimortem?
The appearance. As I told you, in the bruise, you'll have bleeding. In abrasions, you'll be more reddish brown and darker reddish brown. One way to definitely prove your point would be to take a microscopic section and look at the tissue, or you can also do analysis of the tissue, which is not readily available, to study for these presence of these hormones.
And how do you distinguish postmortem?
Postmortem will be pale, and you won't have any bleeding or any reaction to the tissue if you take a microscopic section.
How about on contusions? Is there any difference in what you're looking for to distinguish an antemortem, perimortem, or postmortem contusion?
Postmortem, you won't get you won't have the bleeding into the tissues as you see with an antemortem contusion.
Your Honor, I have another chart because we're going to be moving into, Doctor, the actual protocols in these two cases, Ronald Goldman and Nicole Brown Simpson. Your Honor, I'd ask that this chart entitled Anatomical Terms be marked as exhibit, I think, 343.
343.
I should have watched Mr. Fairlow. I might have been able to do this on my own. Doctor, when you as a forensic pathologist look at wounds on the body, do you attempt to describe the location of any such wound when you are dictating an autopsy protocol?
Yes.
These terms that are used, these six terms that are used on our Exhibit 343, do they have meaning to you as a forensic pathologist for the purposes of identifying where on the body a particular wound is located?
Yes.
What do they mean to you, Doctor?
Anterior means towards the front of the body. Posterior means towards the back of the body.
If you'll stop, when you say the front of the body, are you talking about the front chest area?
Yes.
Okay, and the back of the body would be to literally the back side?
Yes.
Are these relative terms? That is, a wound may be anterior to something or posterior to something?
Yes, but still the word anterior means that means that particular structure in the context you're describing was towards the front of the body.
What about 3 and 4? What do they represent?
Superior and inferior refers to... Superior means towards the head region. Inferior means towards the toe region. And of course, the diagram you have on the poster board is the body in anatomical position.
Let me ask you, is that a recognized term of art, the anatomic position?
Yes, the anatomic position is the body being erect, arms by the side, with the palms and face facing to the front.
Doctor, if I stand here and myself out in this fashion, have I taken the anatomic position?
Yes, your arms should be a little bit closer to your body, and your feet should be a little bit closer. That's right.
And is this a recognized format to use to give relative positions of injuries that are identified on the body of a person on whom an autopsy is being performed?
Yes, and that is a position we give all our descriptions. We use that, keep that position in mind, especially when we give trajectories.
Doctor, there are two more items listed, 5 and 6, lateral and medial. What do they mean?
Lateral means away from the center of the body. Medial means towards the center of the body.
I want to ask you about a couple of terms, four actually, that are not on this exhibit 343. Mr. Farrell, is this a permanent marker?
Yes.
Doctor, I want to write the term radial, R-A-D-I-A-L, on a portion of the diagram. I want to write the term ulnar on another portion of the diagram. I want to write the term dorsal, D-O-R-S-A-L, my spelling's accurate, on a third part of the diagram. And I want to write a term ventral on a fourth part of the diagram. Doctor, do these terms have meaning to you as a forensic pathologist?
Yes.
Let's start with radial. What is this another relative term of position?
Yes.
What does it mean?
Radial comes from the origin is, if you stand in the anatomical position, may I stand, Your Honor?
Oh, how about if I stand in the anatomical position and with the board's permission, you step to the board, or step to me, actually, and point out what it is.
If you see Mr. Kelberg in the anatomical position, the arm has a bone called the humerus, and the forearm has two bones. One is called the radius, and one is called the ulna. The radius is situated on the outer aspect of the forearm. And in the anatomical position, it is the outermost bone in this position. So radial, in a way, could, in this particular position, would be lateral to the lateral to the ulna.
And in lay terms, doctor, could we think of it in terms of radial is on the thumb side of the hand when the hand is in the anatomic position?
Yes.
And where is ulnar?
Ulnar is on the little finger side. It's on the other bone on the inner side of the forearm.
Now, can you use me, before I have to move, to identify what dorsal and ventral mean?
Dorsal is another term for the back, and ventral is another term for the front. And in this situation, ventral would be the palm aspect of the hand. Dorsal would be the back of the hand.
And in general, doctor, on exhibit 343, have I written the terms, if one uses the hand, thumb, and little finger of the schematic of the human anatomy, written them in the approximate positions that they refer to as you've described? And if you need a, here's a marker. Why don't you draw a line to where you believe they represent? Your Honor, may the record reflect that with that marker, Dr. Lakshmanan has drawn four lines, each with an arrow at the end, where it is in proximity to the appropriate word. We have a moment with the counsel. Your Honor, I have a series of exhibits to be marked. As exhibit 344, I have what appears to be a 13-page autopsy protocol for Nicole Brown Simpson.
All right, 344 will be protocol regarding Nicole Brown Simpson.
And could that be 344A? I'm sorry, Your Honor.
344A.
I have a Form 15 for Nicole Brown Simpson as 344B.
All right, so marked.
A Form 16 for Nicole Brown Simpson as C.
344C.
A diagram Form 20 for Nicole Brown Simpson as D. A diagram Form 22 for Nicole Brown Simpson as E. A Form 23 diagram for Nicole Brown Simpson as F. A 20F form diagram for Nicole Brown Simpson as G. A 20G diagram form for Nicole Brown Simpson as H. A Form 24 for Nicole Brown Simpson as I. A 20H form diagram for Nicole Brown Simpson as J. A 20G form diagram for Nicole Brown Simpson as K.
I thought we had 20G as 344H.
There are two different 20Gs, Your Honor, I believe. And I'm not sure it's two 20Gs and maybe two 20Hs. Yes, it is two different form 20Gs. They are completely different forms. They have the same form number. That'll become clear in a moment. Let me just...
All right, I'll take your word for it.
Let me, for clarification, K appears to be what Dr. Lakshmanan previously identified as the diagram of the skull and internal area of the head. And the 20G, which was our earlier subpart H, appears to be a diagram of the neck and top of the head.
Noted.
Then as Form 29 for Nicole Brown Simpson would be L. And Form 20H, this one appearing to be an outline of the skeleton. I think we had another 20H, which is an outline of the human skull. But this is the skeleton of the entire body. This as Exhibit M. And a Form 20D as in dog that for Nicole Brown Simpson I asked to be marked as Exhibit O, subpart O.
How about N?
N? I'm sorry. N then. Your Honor, I have what appears to be a two-page document entitled Addendum Report. That is, has both typing and handwriting on it. May this be marked as Exhibit 345.
All right, People's 345, two-page addendum.
In fact, 345A. And I, there may be a reason for that, Your Honor, because I seem to have another two-page addendum report that is all typed, and ask that that two-page document be Exhibit 345B.
Yes.
And then I have, Your Honor, a one-page Form 14 entitled Microscopic Description that applies to Nicole Brown Simpson, and I ask that that be marked as 345C.
So marked.
I have, Your Honor, what appear to be two pages of toxicology reports for Nicole Brown Simpson, one dated June 21, 94, one dated August 31, 94, I'd ask respectively that they be marked as 346A and B.
So marked.
I have a two-page Form 13 odontology report dated September 9, 1994 for Nicole Brown Simpson. I ask that that be marked as 347A.
Is that Dr. Vail's report?
It is, Your Honor. And I have a second Form 13 odontology report dated September 14, 1994 for Nicole Brown Simpson that I would ask to be marked as 347B that also involves Dr. Vail. I have, Your Honor, another Form 13 entitled Radiology Consult dated November 14th of 1994. May that be 347C.
347C.
And finally, Your Honor, in this series, I have what appears to be a two-page typewritten document entitled Forensic Laboratory Analysis Report from Stephen J. Dowell, which has a stamp on the second page at the bottom, received October 27, 1994. May that be marked as Exhibit 347D, as in dog.
So marked. All right, is that the complete series, Mr. Kelberg?
Your Honor, I have two more documents to mark.
All right.
Which collectively I would ask to be marked as Exhibit 348. One is the Form 1 report that we previously saw, a copy of Exhibit 298, I believe A, for Nicole Brown Simpson, and two page two forms, Form 2, two separate pages, both dated June 13th of 1994 for Nicole Brown Simpson. I ask that all three of these pages be collectively marked as Exhibit 348.
All right.
And that does complete the series of exhibits to be marked.
All right. We're going to take a 10-minute court reporter recess at this time. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, please remember all of my admonitions to you. This will be a short break to change court reporters, and we'll see you back here in about 10 minutes. All right, Doctor, you can step down. Present.
Can we just have one more moment to set up the second easel?
Be my guest. Sure. counsel. All right, let's have the jurors, please.
I think you mentioned something earlier this afternoon about one-to-one photographs. Did you use that term?
Yes, I did.
What does that refer to?
That is an enlargement of the photograph to depict the best reflection of the anatomical region, a life-size type photograph. And the way we do it in our office or with the assistance of the LAPD lab. As I told you earlier, we have a coroner's blue card which is placed in any area which is being photographed in the coroner's office, and the card is always incorporated in the field of photography. So what the process involves is taking a real size card and enlarging the negative to correspond to this size. I'm not a photographic expert, but basically what the end result is, you get a life-size image of the region photographed, and it's the best reflection of the anatomical region as Dr. Golden would have seen it on June 14th and as I saw it on June 13th.
Doctor, have you reviewed life-size photographs of nearly all of the coroner's photographs that were taken of Nicole Brown Simpson?
Yes.
Are there some photographs that were not blown up to life-size proportion?
That is correct.
Why is that?
Because you have full-length views of the body, you need a 6 foot, I mean, 5 feet, 5 inch length of paper to accommodate such a photograph.
But in the photographic process you identified earlier, part of the process is to give up-close photographs of matters that are deemed of significance in the course of the autopsy and even before the autopsy?
Yes.
And as to those photographs, have they been blown up to life size to give, as accurate as possible, a true reflection of the size and appearance of any such wound or injury or finding of significance?
A two-dimensional view.
Is there a limitation created from reviewing, even with life-size photographs, is there a limitation to that process in allowing you to, with precision, measure, for example, the injuries that were, in fact, on the body of Nicole Brown Simpson at the time of the autopsies?
There are several limitations. One, as I mentioned, photographs are two-dimensional views. It's not a three-dimensional examination. Number one. Number two, you really cannot approximate wounds. If the wounds have been photographed in the gaping state, you have them in the gaping state. You don't have the ability to approximate and measure them. The third issue is if the wound is on a curvature of the body, and the photographer is not taken at right angles to the curvature, there's distortion involved. Fourthly, if the card is not next to the injury you're examining, you have that factor to be kept in mind, because the measurement you do may not necessarily reflect the exact measurement. So there are limitations to the process, but it is the best reflection of the injuries in the anatomical area possible in this type of examination.
Doctor, short of exhuming a body, are you aware of any better process than the use of life-size photographs to evaluate the wounds as they appeared at the time of an autopsy?
No.
Are there, in fact, limitations that would make exhumation of the body less of a reliable basis than the use of life-size photographs?
It'll be less reliable because if you exhume a body, you're going to have changes of decomposition and distortion of the wounds anyway.
And doctor, I have an envelope that appears to be quite full with materials. Is this basically the size of the type of photographs that you've looked at that would be described as one-to-one photographs?
Yes.
Kelberg, do you want to estimate that for the record?
By weight or number of photographs?
How about the size of the photographs and the approximate number?
The size of the envelope and the extension of the photograph would appear to make length 20 inches,
make width of photograph 12 inches. Doctor, are you able to tell us the number of photographs of the body of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ronald Goldman, which collectively were taken?
I think there were about 62 photographs of Ron Goldman and I think about 32. I have the exact numbers in the file.
Some of those photographs, however, depict clothing in each case. Is that correct?
The photographic number I referred to is basically the initial photographs. There have been numerous photographs taken of the evidence, the tissues, the clothing, which I'm not taking into the count.
And those are the photographs that would be contained in your one-to-one set you reviewed?
The autopsy photograph, the initial photographs which was taken by the coroner's office.
Your Honor, is that an adequate description for the court? Now, Doctor, we're going to be looking at some photographs shortly. In looking at the photographs that we will be seeing, have some of those photographs been cropped, that is, cut in compliance with an order from Judge Ito?
Yes.
As you looked at the photographs, both in the size that they were originally before cropping, you did do that, is that correct?
Yes.
And in looking at the one-to-ones, have you looked at the whole photograph?
Yes, I have.
Your Honor, I have a series of documents that has the heading Outline of Injuries to Nicole Brown Simpson 94-05136. May this be marked as Exhibit 349?
I think it's 350.
I'm sorry?
350.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see where Mr. Lynch had marked the collective boards. Then 350.
And as 351, a similar appearing set of documents, thicker in number, I believe, entitled Outline of Injuries to Ronald Goldman, 94-05135, as 351.
So marked.
Doctor, let me show you first Exhibit 350, the series of documents on Nicole Brown Simpson.
Are you familiar in general terms with this exhibit?
Yes, I am.
What is this?
This is an exhibit which I played an important part, and it was prepared principally to present my findings after reviewing the 1:1 photographs. And I did it and also look at the autopsy description in the original protocol, also correlate these injury descriptions with diagrams in the original autopsy protocol. In addition, we also correlated the injuries in the addendum description, and following this we also have a comment section and also an opinion from me whether it's a single edge or a double edge whether it's a single edge or double edge, which you cannot say. That comment section is also included in this chart. It's important that this chart was done to identify any, because when the original addendum was done, the measurement of the injuries was not done with 1:1 photographs, the injuries which were not described earlier. And that is why the 1:1 photographs were useful. And basically the chart has these headings, and once the chart is shown to you will understand the format as I just presented.
Doctor, would it be accurate to say that this document is to reflect your identification of every wound or injury that you found in looking at all of the autopsy photographs of Nicole Brown Simpson?
Yes.
Is it intended to identify areas within Dr. Golden's original autopsy report where any such wounds were described?
Yes.
Is it intended to identify any of those diagrams, those form number forms that we looked at earlier,
where any such injury or wound was marked on the form by Dr. Golden at the time of the autopsy?
Yes.
Is it intended to identify areas of injury that Dr. Golden did not address, that is, did not include any reference to in his original protocol?
Yes.
Or did not diagram in one or more of the forms used by Dr. Golden in the course of his autopsy?
Yes.
Now, Doctor, in this case, did Dr. Golden prepare something called an addendum report?
Yes.
How did that come about?
He prepared the addendum because he felt that he had not addressed some of the injuries on the photographs, which he had seen but he had failed to describe in the original report. I also brought to his attention, following my examination of the tissues on June 22nd, that he had failed to describe a contusion of the brain, which was in the whole jar, which was not addressed to the original report. And based on these factors, Dr. Golden issued an addendum report under my direction.
Doctor, did you talk with Dr. Golden before any final addendum report was completed?
Yes, I did.
At that time, did you discuss with him a draft addendum that he may have prepared?
Yes, I did.
Let me pull out one of these boards for just a moment. It has the number 7B on the back from our exhibit of 349, Your Honor. And Mr. Carroll, was this set up in the appropriate location, this particular easel?
Yes, it is.
Doctor, in looking at that blow-up that is right next to you, are you familiar?